You're on a Zoom call with a bad connection and you're wondering, is it my internet or theirs? Today we're going down the rabbit hole to learn why your internet isn't always as fast as you think it should be. Specifically, we're going to learn how the internet actually works so it's not such a black box, then talk about upload and download speeds and what they really mean. If you've been following my other videos, you'll know that we've started a series on how screensavers actually work under the hood and that you can even build one yourself. Feel free to check that out and don't worry, we'll get back to that series real soon. I'm out at the lake right now with my in-laws, and this summer, internet has been a hot topic. Everyone's working remotely, and my family's asking things like, why are my Zoom calls so glitchy? YouTube works fine usually, but sometimes it's really slow for no reason. Same with Netflix. Why can't internet just be good always? Well, to help answer this, I'm going to be like your grandpa for a second and tell you that you kids don't know how good you've had it. But seriously, the fact that you can simply just tap on a computer in your hand and instantly talk to your friend, colleague, brother, sister, mom, dad in real time without even a wire connecting you to is actually amazing, isn't it? Okay, yeah, we do this every day now, but really, how does it actually work? And if we can answer that, what makes it fast or slow? If you live in the city, your internet probably works like this. You got your phone or computer or smart TV or literally anything else these days. You got your home router. This listens for Wi-Fi messages from any of these devices so that you can talk wirelessly. Your router connects to a modem. And why do we need a modem, or like what even is a modem? The modem translates all the messages that you're sending through your router to a format that can run over a much longer cable. This cable is headed to your internet provider. This longer cable can be one of many things depending on where you live. If you're in an older building with phone cables installed, your internet provider can actually piggyback on top of this phone line to transmit your internet data. This is called DSL. Now, if you're in a somewhat newer building, you might have a long copper cable called a coax cable, and this would run out of your house underground. And then the newest places these days would have a fiber optic cable, which literally uses light beams to send signals. Fiber optics are pretty incredible. No matter which way you bend the wire, the light can travel and curve along the cable. And since light is faster than anything else, fiber tends to be one of the fastest cables to send data over. And this would provide the best connection of those three 99% of the time. Now, usually these cables will make their way to a shared node within your neighborhood before then getting relayed to your internet provider's data center. Now, if you live in a remote area, things are a bit different. If you're lucky enough to have a phone line run into your place, you can usually piggyback on that. Like we just talked about, that's called DSL, though you can expect really slow speeds, and we'll explain a little bit more why that's the case later. You might have traditional satellite internet where you literally have a dish on your roof that's pointing to satellites that are orbiting the Earth. Again, though, this will be slow, probably the slowest of them all. Plus, your internet provider is probably going to be enforcing some data caps and make you sign up for these long-term contracts. Now, if you've been following Elon Musk's Starlink company, you'll know that they're trying to change this by deploying low Earth satellites into the atmosphere, low enough that you can actually get good speeds again, sometimes speeds similar to what you'd actually get in the city. And finally, we have point-to-point Wi-Fi dishes that literally just use Wi-Fi to send a signal to your provider. But unlike a regular router that just broadcasts the Wi-Fi signal in a small radius around it, they direct it in one single direction using what's basically a satellite dish, allowing you to send that signal in distances of kilometers instead of meters. This is perfect if you're close enough to a town or if your provider has towers set up by more of a major town where you're able to relay the messages between these towers until it gets to the main point of presence or the data center. Now, you won't be getting fiber speeds, but they can be usable. And this is actually exactly how I'm getting internet right now. Okay, great. So now we know how the internet gets from your place to your internet provider. But then what happens after that? Is there like a central internet hub that everybody connects to? No, and this is the beauty of the internet. Basically, everybody is connected to everybody. Kind of. Your internet provider maybe talks to five other internet providers, and then those providers talk to other providers. Now, this isn't 100% true. Nowadays, you'll have what's called an internet exchange point, which basically acts as a switch between multiple providers so that it's easier for everyone to talk to everybody. So anyways, you keep going and going and going, and then you have providers in North America talking to Europe, and Europe talking to Australia, and they're all interconnected. Which, by the way, is why they call it the internet. Literally, it is just a network of computers interconnected internet. All right, so we've uncovered the internet and mostly understand how a message can be sent from, say, your smartphone to anywhere else in the world. But you might be thinking, that's great, Greg, but what about our original problem of slow internet? You've sure gone down the rabbit hole here. Well, here's why it was important to first understand how the internet works. Because a slow connection can really happen at any single one of these points along that path. Which, if you think about it, is again really impressive that anything actually works. There are so many places it could go wrong. Well, thankfully, certain parts of this path are very resilient. For example, connections between your two internet providers will use expensive, fault-tolerant, enterprise-grade routers and equipment that will always stay running and also has a ton of bandwidth. But even if you were to break this connection, and this does happen, we have that redundancy of routing through a different provider if you need to. And so if a connection was going through this segment but now gets rerouted through a different segment, well, it'll just continue going through that other provider who is probably likely talking to somebody else downstream that you need to talk to, and it will just get routed through a different path. This whole rerouting, by the way, would happen instantly. Another reason why the internet's so incredible. From your home, however, you almost always just have a single connection. And if that connection is slow or breaks, that's it. There's no backup. There's no redundancy. Unless you were to, I guess, turn off Wi-Fi on your phone and connect to data. Some businesses will actually sign up for internet through two separate providers for this exact reason. So that if one were to go down, you would have that second one as redundancy. So your home usually just has that single connection. And this brings up the first reason why you may be experiencing slow internet. Something is wrong in this area of your connection. As you probably know already, the first place to try when you have internet problems is your router. Have you tried turning it off and on again? No, but especially if it's a Wi-Fi router and you're trying to connect wirelessly to it, your connection speed can vary drastically depending on a couple situations. First of all, how strong is your Wi-Fi signal? And how far away are you from your router? Maybe there's a big cement block between you and the router. Okay, that one's obvious. But when's the last time you counted the number of devices connecting to your Wi-Fi router? I forget about this one all the time. Nowadays, with everything being smart, the average house has a ton of devices connected, probably more than you think. You got your laptop, desktop, smartphone, of course, but also smart TV, smart watch, iPad or tablet, Chromecast, not to mention all the other smart devices you can get today. Wi-Fi cameras, smart lights, door locks, doorbells, smart garage door openers, you name it. So with all these things, for every member of your household, each person might be bringing 5+ devices to your network. By the time you add all these up, you could have 30+ devices on your network, or maybe even way more than that, depending on how big your family is and how many smart devices you have. And perhaps your Wi-Fi router was actually never designed to handle that many connections. Now you're saying, okay, Greg, I'm not an idiot. I've got a brand new router. I've made sure the thing has the strongest signal strength. It can handle lots of devices, hundreds of devices, and I'm not hiding behind a cement wall. Okay, well that's good because now we can start shifting the blame. Between you and your internet provider, here's what can go wrong. Regardless of whether or not you have copper or fiber leaving your house, if you live in a residential area, especially the suburbs, your line probably ends up in a shared node within your neighborhood. From there, you and all your neighbors' connections are combined into just one single line that goes to your internet provider. Now, depending on how new and modern this shared node is, it may not have been designed to handle as much traffic as you might think it should. In fact, pretty much every internet provider oversubscribes their neighborhood, meaning that if every single person were to connect to the internet at the same time and use their maximum amount of bandwidth together, that node actually would not be able to handle all that traffic, and everyone would be getting a reduced speed that's lower than what was actually advertised. And this does happen. This could be why your internet is slow. You might have noticed that at peak times, so like evenings and weekends, when everyone's using the internet at the same time, your internet just feels slow. And this is why they advertise you can get up to those speeds, but not actually guaranteed those speeds. Now, before you pull out your pitchforks, it's still probably better this way. If internet providers actually built their equipment to support those max speeds of everyone's connections combined, which by the way could change at any time, if Bobby was on the 25 megabit per second plan right now and then upgrades to the 500 megabit per second plan, the infrastructure would need to support that. So really, providers would need to build their equipment to support the maximum possible speeds that somebody could ever want to have, even if that's not what they have today, multiplied by the number of residents in that neighborhood. It sounds ideal, but this would cost your provider magnitudes more to build and maintain the equipment for that. And this cost would, you guessed it, get forwarded right back to you, the customer. So whatever you're paying now could end up being like 10 times the price. But if you are constantly slowed down at peak times, it's probably time for your provider to at least upgrade the equipment to a higher capacity than what it is today. Newer communities will usually have the best connections because everyone runs fiber from their house directly to these nodes, and that shared node usually has a higher capacity to send that data upstream to the ISP. For those who like to get technical, I'd recommend researching GPON, which is a popular technology being used today to multiplex internet traffic from multiple people's lines into a single line. One of the coolest things about GPON is that it is passive, which means it's using a physical optical splitter in order to multiplex a connection. This is as opposed to an active optical network, which would require a electrical switch to multiplex the traffic. Now, if you're not in the city and have one of those other types of connections, things can definitely go wrong there too. If you're connected to a satellite, well, that's just always slow, like we talked about before. But on top of that, any kind of bad weather you might be experiencing will definitely affect that connection. Same with the point-to-point Wi-Fi. If you're in the middle of a storm and the wind is blowing these dishes around, it's hard to maintain that strong connection. If you're getting your internet over a phone line, like we talked about before, DSL, this will already be slow, but even slower the longer distances you run. And there's really not much you can do about this, unfortunately, apart from running a whole new line, which, by the way, should be a fiber line if you're going to do this yourself. Or, of course, switch into a different internet connection method. Okay, we need to talk about that strange situation where you can stream something just fine over Netflix or YouTube, but as soon as you do a video call like Zoom, suddenly everything seems laggy. Or maybe for you, everybody else on the call appears fine, but then they're saying, hey, you're cutting out, we can't hear you, we can't see you. What is going on? To answer this, we need to understand a key part of every internet connection, and that is your upload and download speeds. Every internet connection is split into two parts. Either upload traffic, which is traffic sent from you to somebody else, or download traffic, which is the opposite, data that's coming from somewhere else sent to you. When you signed up for your internet package, you might have seen something like 100 megabits per second download speeds and 10 megabit per second upload speeds. What does this really mean? It means you can download or receive 100 million bits per second. And what's a bit? Well, a bit is that one or zero in a computer. Basically, every single thing in your computer has to boil down to a one or zero at the end of the day, and that's what gets sent over the wire. If this is something you're interested to learn more about, let me know and we can dive into that in another video. So back to 100 megabits per second download, 10 megabit per second upload. You'll see the situation where there are two different speeds, usually if you don't have fiber. If you have fiber, typically that number will be the same, right? You'll get 100 megabits down and 100 megabits upload. And when these speeds are exactly the same, like in fiber, you'd call that a symmetric internet connection. And when they're different, you call that an asymmetric connection. So how come these non-fiber lines have to be asymmetric? How come they need to have that lower upload speed with a bigger download speed? Well, these lines typically have a lower capacity than fiber, which means you need to split that internet traffic somehow, right? Think of it like a big pipe. At the end of the day, you just have this pipe that can support X amount of traffic. And you need to decide, okay, how much of that pipe am I going to use to download and how much of that pipe am I going to use to upload? So let's pretend the max bandwidth that your cable supports is 110 megabits per second. What your provider is doing is they're deciding that they would rather split that 110 versus something like 55 and 55. And why would they do that? Why give the download so much more than the upload? Well, the majority of residential internet traffic is download. When you're streaming Netflix, YouTube, browsing the web, scrolling through Instagram pictures, pretty much all this data is coming from a server out there and getting downloaded to your phone. Yes, you still use a little bit of upload. Of course, you need that. Your phone has to create a message that says, hey, you should send me those latest Instagram photos. And then you send that message to the server, that's upload. But this message is usually super tiny. It's just like a request. So if you're only getting that 10 megabit per second upload with the 100 megabit per second download, this explains why something like Netflix feels perfectly fine, but as soon as you do a video call, you have a problem. The same thing were to happen if you were to upload a photo or a video, say to Instagram, or in my case, to YouTube. Depending on how big your file is, that could take a long time, depending on what your upload speeds are. Finally, and probably most commonly, we have one more situation that can cause slow internet. Too many streamers. At the cottage here, my internet speed isn't amazing. I get about 5 megabits per second down and 1 or sometimes less than 1 megabit per second upload. If my wife and I are watching a show together, we usually have no problem. Fun fact, YouTube and Netflix actually support adaptive streaming, which means you start off at a lower quality so that you can get your video right away until enough of that video has buffered, and then it will upgrade you to a higher quality over time. So watching that show together, no problem. However, as soon as we start watching our own video separately, everything seems to grind to a halt. And this is because instead of streaming, or in this case, downloading a video at 5 megabits per second, we're splitting that between two people and we each get half that, 2.5 megabits per second. And then for every additional person that you add to that equation, you're basically splitting that pie even more and even more. you have five people, you're each getting like 1 megabit per second. So what do you do about that? Well, if you're on a business call and then your kids are streaming Netflix, you could tell them to go play outside. Or otherwise, if your router supports it, you can turn on what's called QoS, which stands for quality of service. This basically tells your router to prioritize certain devices over others. So you could set up a rule that basically makes your computer, your phone, a high priority when it comes to traffic, and everything else a lower priority. Or you could tell your router to prioritize certain types of traffic, say always prioritize traffic that looks like a video call over something that looks like a Netflix stream. All right, that's it for today. I hope you learned something new or at least found something interesting. Thanks for watching, and I'll catch you down the next rabbit hole.